of 2019, how will that figure in terms of ratifying a new constitution and yet electing officials under the 1987 constitution? So we'd like some of these concerns ratified. I mean, sorry, clarified. Masyado na akong paulit-ulit ang constitutional change and ratification, kaya miss na ko. Also, well, going back to the earlier points, it is really a desire to decentralize and allocate more resources equitably from the national capital region that brings us to this situation as to whether or not we should pursue charter change, whether or not we should support federalism. Magandang pakinggan ang ideya ng isang federal na Pilipinas, ang decentralisasyon ng political at ekonomikong kapangyarihan sa malayong kanayunan, kasabay ng kalaunang pagbibigay lakas sa mga mamamayan at mga pangarap nila. Sa madaling sabi, hindi ba pwedeng, kinakailangan bang federalismo o decentralisasyon, o hindi siya isa o ang pangalawa? Tulad ng mga paggagawa ng batas halimbawa para magbigay ng dagdag na autonomiya, dagdag na pondo para magtalaga ng mas maraming kapangyarihan at para maglaan ng mas malaking pondo sa lokal, tsatsa ba o batas? Ngayong araw na ito, titingnan natin mabuti at bubususiin ang mga panukalang batas. Sa pagdinig na ito, pinadala namin ang mga sumusunod na katanungan sa ating mga panauhin na tungkol sa dalawang paksa, ang federalismo at decentralization, at ang epekto ng charter change sa eleksyon at sa mga termino ng mga nakaupo. Sa federalismo at decentralization, itinuturo ng mga kalahok sa mga nakalipas nating mga pagdinig at konsultasyon ang pangangailangan ng magtalaga ng mas maraming kapangyarihan at o mga mapagtutustusan mula sa sentro papunta sa lokal. Upang matugunan ito, iminumungkahi ng ilan na mag-adapt ng federal form of government sa pamamagitan ng charter change, habang inimumungkahi naman ng ilan ang decentralization sa pamamagitan ng pagsasabatas nito. Merong mga nagsabi na ang local government code, and the father of the local government code is here with us, thank you, Senate President Pimentel, ay dapat pang pasiglahin. Merong mandatong pag-aralan ito every 5 years, subalit hindi ito na nagawa mula noong 1991. And therefore, sinasabing batas ba o pagbabago ng saligang batas. Subalit, mananatiling mga pahayag lamang ang mga mungkahing ito, kaya nais po nating malaman. Number one, ito ang mga tanong. Anong particular na pagbabago ang dapat i-adapt sa paglipat sa federalismo? Anong forma ba ang dapat piliin? Ano ang magiging kalabasan ng revenue at expenditure structure sa federal state at sa federal level at state level? Aling mga pangangailangan at layunin ang matutugunan sa mga partikular na pagbabagong ito? At pangatlo, matutugunan ba ang mga pangangailangan at layunin na ito sa ibayong decentralization or greater decentralization sa pamamagitan ng angkop ng mga batas? Sa madalit sabi, aling federal system ang ating gagamitin? Anong magiging itsura ng isang Filipino federal system? Paghahati-hatiin ba natin ang mga probinsya sa mga estado? Paano natin igugrupo ang mga probinsya? Ano ang ating basihan? Ano ang magiging papel ng Pangulo sa gaanong patakaran? Sa ganoong patakaran? Bicameral o unicameral ba ang magiging federal government? Ano ang magiging papel ng mga mambabatas? Magkakaroon ba ng mga senador at party list representatives? Ano ang naging karanasan sa ibang mga bansa sa pag-federalize? These are some of our questions that hopefully we will be able to tackle today. At sa usapin ng charter change, ano ang timetable para sa prosesong ito? Base sa timetable na ito, posible ba ang no-election scenario sa May 2019? Paano? Ano-ano ang mga implikasyon ng isang no-el scenario, kung meron bang senaryong ganito sa May 2019. Kung papalitan natin ang saligang batas, papayagan bang tumakbo muli yung mga kasalukuyang nakaupong opisyal na umabot na sa kanilang term limit, na para bang tatakumpalan sila muli nung unang termino? In other words, meron bang lifting of term limits? Dagdag pa rito, meron ba tayong budget para dito? At magkano ang kailangan nating ilaan? Sa huli, nais malaman ng publiko, anong pipigil sa mga pamilya na nakatatak na sa politika at negosyo sa kanilang lokalidad mula sa lalong pangingibabaw sa mga bagong tatag na estado? In other words, the political dynasty issue. Mapipigilan ba ito ng bagong saligang batas? I hear that the Constitutional Commission, Consultation Commission, Consultative Commission has come up with its position, and we would like to hear that on political dynasties. Ano ba ang magagawa o hindi magagawa ng bagong saligang batas na wala sa mga reformang nasa local government code na meron tayo ngayon? Ito po ang ilan sa ating mga katanungan, and we hope to have very healthy exchange of views, whether for or against federalism, whether for or against decentralization, and hopefully in the end the citizens themselves will have a better grasp of the issues, because in the final analysis it will be our citizens who will decide as to how we are to proceed in terms of constitutional amendments as it is being proposed. With that, for the record, we will just place on record the following are here with us. Former Senate President Nene Pimentel, also a member of the Consultative Committee to Review the 1987 Constitution. From the League of Provinces of the Philippines, Ms. Sandra Tablan Paredes. From the Academe, we have Dr. Francisco Magno, Director, DLSU Institute of Governance. We also have UP Political Science Department, Professor Jean Pilapil. We also have from the Philippine Institute for Development Studies, Dr. Rosario Manasan. From NAMFREL, we have the Secretary General, Mr. Eric Jude Alvia. We have Secretary General of the Student Council Alliance of the Philippines, Mr. Isaac Sagit. From the COMELEC, Albert Rodriguez. Also from the DILG, ASEC Rico Judge Echeverry. Magandang umaga po sa kanilang lahat. As in previous hearings, we will allow our, unless they wish to proceed or forego and proceed with question and answers, we will allow our resource persons opening statements of 5 to 7 minutes. Perhaps you can start with Senator Nene Pimentel. Would you like to begin, or would you like to allow others?
Yeah. I have been repeating about myself already several times, Mr. Chairman, so maybe you should hear from the other panelists here.
Yes, sir. And then we will, if any of our resource persons would like to react.
In any event, may I just make a general overview of what we intend to do under a federalist proposal regarding the Republic of the Philippines?
Yes,
perhaps,
please.
Mr. Chairman, we should start with viewing the Republic of the Philippines not only as consisting of Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao, but also Scarborough, Spratlys, Benham Rice, and even Sabah. In other words, these are the things that I'd like to start with by pointing out that under our proposal, we intend to suggest that we create 12 federal states for the entire Republic of the Philippines. Lima sa Luzon, Northern Luzon, Central Luzon, the Cordilleras, Bicol, and then Southern Tagalog. Metro Manila will not be converted into a federal state, but will remain as the capital of the federal state, like New Delhi in India, or Kuala Lumpur in Malaysia, or Washington DC in the US. These are capitals of federal republics, but are not federal states on their own. Then in the Visayas, Eastern Visayas, Central Visayas, the Ilonggo provinces, plus the two provinces of Mindoro, Palawan, Romblon, at saka Marinduque. Because as a sign of the imperialist thinking of people in Metro Manila, Mr. Chairman, this is considered up to today as part of Region 4B. I mean, how can this be a part of Luzon when these are located in the seas of the Visayas? And then in Mindanao, we are suggesting three. Northern Mindanao, from the tip of Sambonga all the way up to Surigao, a wide stretch of land, which may be, subdivided probably later, but to make our discussions a little more, less complicated, I might say, we just suggest Northern Mindanao, Southern Mindanao, and then the Bangsamoro. And Bangsamoro, Mr. Chairman, is the most important federal state, because without it, unless the culture and tradition of the Muslim people are fully respected, the shooting war in this country will continue, dissipating the resources of the nation, which would be better used to promote the health and security of the nation. So maraming salamat po, Mr. Chairman, for that opportunity.
Maraming salamat, Senate President Pimentel. Senate President Pimentel, would you kindly also give us some updates regarding what the consultative committee has done, so that the committee...
We were talking yesterday about who to ban from running for public office, up to what extent, for civil degree ba, up to the second degree. And by a vote of 10 over 9, the proposal to limit it to the second degree was adopted. So hanggang tatay, nanay lang, at saka. Although I was suggesting that we should include in the definition the relationship of public officials with their mistresses. Because my goodness, I mean, don't tell me that just because this is outside the legitimate relationship, therefore it should be tolerated. So, but that has still to be defined, Mr. Chairman. Then, secondly, there was a proposal yesterday to include in the ban against political dynasties all elective positions up to the barangay. That was hindi lang dito sa itaas. Now, one of the issues that I raised is that, okay, well, pwede up to barangay, pero paano kung merong members of the same family na nag-away talaga? Or really fighting? Sino ang i-disqualify mo roon? So, these are some of the things that we are still refining, because the exact wording, Mr. Chairman, still has to be refined accordingly. So, basically, Mr. Chairman, yun ang aming napag-usapan.
Senate President Nene, with respect to the timetable, does the committee have a timetable within which to come up with its report and submit it to the President?
Mr. Chairman, ang aming nalaman that our report is supposed to be submitted on time for the SONA of the President in July. So medyo maikpit talaga.
Yes. The reason why we're raising this, and for the record, is that the committee would also like to, have a copy of yes. of the report.
Yes.
As we initially we were working on a timetable of coming up with our committee report and findings March or April, but I guess out of courtesy as well to the committee, we would like to get additional inputs from this committee, from your committee, sir, so that we can likewise incorporate portions of your report in our committee report. But of course, this is something that I have to consult with the other members of the committee in terms of our own timetable in the Senate.
But Mr. Chairman, your committee deserves a copy of this report. After all, we are only advisory.
Yes, yes, that is correct.
I mean, we just make a recommendation and it's up to Congress really to hammer out a good proposal.
Thank you, Senator, Senate President Pimentel. We can now proceed with the position papers of our different resource persons. Maybe we can start with the academe. Professor Magno, would you like to have, would you have your opening statement? You have the floor from my alma mater, DLSU. Of course, UP is also my alma mater, so I'm torn between the two. Please proceed, Dr. Magno.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. UP is also my alma mater, but I teach in La Salle, so there's the anima spirit. Thank you for this opportunity. Federalism includes policies designed to recognize and accommodate heterogeneous elements within the majority culture, human and cultural rights provisions, and formal and informal arrangements to guarantee various groups a place in the national decision-making table. In this context, I propose a hybrid form of federalism with two orders of government, the national government and the Bangsamoro regional government. There would be a formal allocation of resources between the orders of government, including some areas of autonomy for each other. These specific changes will address the need for peace and development in the Bangsamoro region. Governments find that using intergovernmental channels to ensure cooperation is often in their collective interests. If applied in a truly democratic manner, hybrid federalism can offer the political space needed to guarantee true regional autonomy. The main problem that besets the country is the lack of equitable and inclusive growth in the country. The answer lies not in creating autonomous regions all over the country as second-order governments. Rather, we should address this through appropriate legislation, participatory budgeting, and strong policy oversight. We should amend the local government code for the purpose of increasing the internal revenue allotment of local government units to enable them to effectively provide public goods and services to their constituents. Additional fiscal transfers should be provided through performance grants for high-performing LGUs and equalization funds for low-income LGUs. We should strengthen the regional development councils as a governance mechanism to address uneven development in the country. This can foster equitable and inclusive growth through the participation of local government units and citizens in development planning and budget prioritization. Section 4 of Executive Order Number 325 on the reorganization of the regional development councils cites that part of the functions of the RDCs, which is composed of at least 25% private sector and civil society representatives, is to review and endorse to the national government the annual budgets of agency regional offices, state colleges and universities, and special development authorities, as well as to coordinate the monitoring and evaluation of development projects. These RDC processes also allow non-government representatives to take part and provide input in the monitoring and implementation of the annual budget. Regions are the key territorial units for local economic development. By the mid-20th century, as urban infrastructures and communications networks spread across national landscapes, urban relations exploded beyond municipal boundaries, generating all kinds of proposals to create larger administrative arenas to correspond with the perceived functional city region. We need to decongest Imperial Manila. We can do this by improving urban planning and creating city regions outside Metro Manila. These city regions, for example, Metro Davao, Metro Cebu, Metro Iloilo, Metro Cagayan de Oro, and Metro Batangas, as just a few examples, could serve as alternative centers of growth, which will fuel inclusive development in the country. this is also based on the concept of federalism. And I think this is a newer concept. Rather than bringing together provinces, we can actually think of the cities as the locus of local economic development. Strengthening regional governance is a mechanism for horizontal and vertical coordination among the different government and societal actors and institutions. We should be thinking of not just government, but really of governance. This would support a whole of government approach rather than a government that operates in silos. What we need is a government that is capable of interoperability with data sharing platforms and able to harmonize systems and processes to improve the delivery of public goods and services. Perhaps we need to have more investments really on e-government, because given the character of our population, the demography, we have a young population. The overarching goal is inclusive and equitable development. In this regard, let me emphasize two specific items that can contribute in addressing these needs in the ongoing constitutional review process. First, we should make the right to information and the right to the internet as constitutionally mandated. Second, we should relax the restrictions on foreign ownership and investments to enhance our national competitiveness. A highly nationalistic country like Vietnam has relaxed foreign investment restrictions to foster national competitiveness for inclusive growth and development. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Professor. We now go to my other alma mater. Professor Jean Pilapil of the UP Political Science Department. You have the floor, sir. Please proceed.
Good morning, Senator.
The microphone, please.
Good morning, Senator Pangilinan. Thank you for the opportunity to speak in this Senate hearing on constitutional amendments. I will answer question 1C first, then my answer to it will be used to deal with questions 1A and 1B. My answer to question 1C is yes, reforms in the local government code can address the delegation of more power and or resources from the central to the local governments in the Philippines without shifting to federalism. Moreover, legislation can do it without the drawbacks, dangers, and divisiveness of overhauling the Constitution just to shift to a federal system of government. My answer is based on the insights of the institutional design literature in political science, the very literature that specializes on the institutional questions the Philippines is currently grappling with, but ironically has barely been recruited to shed light on these questions. Because of time limitations, I could only share two of the many cautionary insights available from the institutional design literature when attempting constitutional overhauls, especially when involving democratic regimes. The first cautionary insight is that there is no consensus on the superiority of a federal to a unitary system of government. This is also true in the case of the form of government debate, where there is no consensus on the superiority of a parliamentary, semi-presidential, to a presidential form of government. While some scholars argue that federal systems of government are superior to unitary systems of government, other scholars find that there is no meaningful difference in the performance between federal and unitary systems on several key indicators. These key indicators include human development, economic performance, income inequality, democratic stability, quality of democracy, rule of law, and anti-corruption. This lack of consensus among scholars of institutional design makes problematic the argument of the overwhelming majority of the pro-federalism literature in the Philippines that takes the superiority of the federal system to a unitary system of government as gospel truth. The second cautionary insight involves the recommendation of top institutional design scholars for democratic countries with already functioning systems or forms of government to reform rather than overhaul their systems or forms of government. The first reason why overhaul is strongly discouraged is because it is unnecessary. If there is no superiority, then there is no need for overhaul. The second reason is because an overhaul is unbelievable. Institutional overhaul tasks are too institutionally and intellectually complex for the lofty goals that proponents talk about. This institutional complexity is especially true for federalism, where, depending on which proposed federal constitution for the Philippines you are reading, state or regional governments, constitutions or organic laws, courts, and bureaucracy, etc., would have to be created. Of the four federal constitutions introduced since 2005, only two bothered to give explicit time frames, and they range from the minimum of 6 years and a half of PDP Laban to a minimum of 10 years of Dr. Jose Abueva, and this is just to start the process of federalism going. This, of course, easily goes beyond the single term of the president currently allowed under the 1987 Constitution, and immediately raises questions on the role of the presidency in the transition. If this is already frowned upon, the overhauling either the form of government or the system of government, it becomes even more problematic because the proposed constitutional overhaul, preferred by President Rodrigo Duterte, involves both the form of government and the system of government. No democratic country with an existing unitary presidential setup has been crazy enough to make these constitutional overhauls at the same time. In terms of intellectually complex, the institutional design literature has sobered from the enthusiasm of the early 1990s on the power to get right the institutional design of political institutions. A good part of this sobering is the realization that actual empirical outcomes of institutional reforms did not conform to the glowing theoretical predictions of reformers. This is true for parliamentarism, semi-presidentialism, and also true for federalism. Thus, the Philippines' constitutional overhaul project circa 2016-2018 is the height of intellectual irony, because as the scholars of the literature on institutional design, the real experts on these issues have counseled caution and moderation. Most proponents of charter change in this country have instead become gung-ho in campaigning to overhaul both systems and forms of government, and at just one go. This raises the question whether intellectually the Philippines' constitutional overhaul project is a matter of hubris and or sheer ignorance of expert literature. The third reason against overhaul is because it is unsafe, especially if the body that will do the rewriting is the same body that benefited from the old unitary setup, like the Philippine Congress, organized as CONAS. This is partly because of the multitude of institutional features needed to make a federal system to work properly. Since most of these features are subject to the inevitable compromises with existing vested interests from government officials who profit from the current unitary system, scholars warn of the grave danger that a constitutional overhaul may produce institutional Frankensteinian outcomes that combine the worst of the old unitary and the new federal systems. On the other hand, piecemeal reforms that move the current setup to a more federalized direction, such as the increased local and regional autonomy in the Philippines, usually involve only legislation. Scholars argue that if there are errors in the reform, it would be easier to return to the old setup or to address the shortcomings through new legislation. This will be excruciatingly difficult to do in a messed up constitutional overhaul, especially involving federalism with its principle of constitutional entrenchment, where the federal features of the Constitution could no longer be changed without the concurrence of the newly created constituent governments. With this position, my answers to questions 1A and 1B should be obvious. Since I believe that the shift to federalism is both unnecessary and counterproductive, questions 1A and 1B are made superfluous by my answer to 1C. On question 2, since I do not believe in charter change to affect federalism, I believe that my answers to questions 2 and 2A would be more effective if I discuss the only actually existing timetable of charter change where a no-election scenario is explicitly discussed. This novel scenario comes from the House of Representatives itself. The novel scenario is the foundation of the House Concurrent Resolution No. 9, which was passed by the House of Representatives on January 16, 2018. It is in the report of Subcommittee 1 of the Committee on Constitutional Amendments that the no-election scenario of May 2019 is assumed. On the other hand, the direct declaration that there will be no election for May 2019 comes mainly from public pronouncements by members of the lower house, led by House Speaker Pantaleon Alvarez. The initial game plan is to have a new federal constitution approved during the barangay elections this coming May 2018. However, this timetable expired even before it started because the Senate did not want to chacha if Congress convened as a CONAS, is to vote jointly and not separately. Now, what are the implications of a no-election scenario in May 2019? Well, there are many, but I list only two of the most important. First, this power grab is damaging to democracy, since Filipino voters will be deprived for one legislative term their fundamental democratic right to vote their representatives in the legislative branch. Voting being the most important political exercise that helps qualify a political system as minimally democratic. Legislators, on the other hand, will undermine their electoral mandate from the public as they are going to occupy office beyond the terms they were voted for. Both the mandate deprived lower house and the Senate will also find their institutions even weaker than they are now, vis-a-vis the already powerful Philippine president who enjoys a robust electoral mandate that is still good for the next half of his term. Second, it is injurious to the charter change campaign itself because it would be exposed as primarily a power grab of self-interested, shameless, and power-hungry legislators who exploit charter change both as a smokescreen and as an excuse to extend themselves in power. Question 2A and 2B are of different natures. Question 2A involves a shameless power grab of changing the rules to avoid elections. Question 2B, which asks, if we were to change the Constitution, would incumbent elected officials who have otherwise reached their term limits be allowed to run in the next elections as if they were running for their first terms? Involves a more sophisticated power grab of changing the rules to allow re-election. So, in one sense, 2A is about a quote-unquote garapal power grab, 2B is a quote-unquote suave power grab. But in one important sense, this latter power grab is even more dangerous than the former. This is because come year 2022, this question will involve the incumbent president himself. And on this re-election question, not only the report of the Committee on Constitutional Amendments of HCR No. 9 gets implicated, but also the proposed federal constitution of Representatives Eugene De Vera and Aurelio Gonzalez Jr. okay, otherwise known as Resolution of Both Houses Number 8 and the PDP Laban Constitution. Because they introduced a new constitution without the provision banning the incumbent president, they must all answer the question whether their new constitution allows the incumbent president of the old constitution, who is barred from running again under the old constitution, to run under the new constitution. One of your resource persons in a previous hearing complained that critics keep on seeing, quote, monsters when there are none, unquote, arguing that there is no term extension for the current president in the PDP Laban Constitution. What he fails to see is the monster he is riding on. Any time that a new constitution is introduced in a presidential democracy with existing term limits for the president, the question of term extension of the incumbent president becomes a central concern. This is not based on the fear of the new, but on knowledge of previous constitutional episodes involving elected strong men who tried to scare term limits of their democracies by coming up with a new constitution. Alberto Fujimori did it in Peru in 1993 with his new constitution that ended the single term limit per president of the 1979 constitution. Hugo Chavez did it in Venezuela in 1999 with his new constitution that ended the 10-year waiting period for a president to run again under the 1961 constitution. Ferdinand Marcos Jr. tried to do it in 1971-1972 to override the 8 consecutive years term limit rule of the 1935 constitution through a constitutional convention to write a new constitution. But Marcos failed, forcing him to fall back on Plan B, which is to declare martial law and terminate Philippine democracy altogether. Changing constitutions is a classic strategy of autocratic leaders elected in democracies but who later undermine their own democracies. This concern on presidential re-election becomes even more serious because the institutional design of the transitory provisions of both HCR number 9 and RBH number 8 gives the incumbent president mind-boggling powers such that the president becomes a one-man hyper-executive legislative package. The powers of the president are almost revolutionary. For example, in the report of Subcommittee 1 of the Committee on Constitutional Amendments of HCR number 9, quote, the incumbent president shall exercise all the powers and functions of the head of state and head of government under this federal constitution until the election of the next president and prime minister in May 2022. He shall appoint the new cabinet from among the members of parliament. He shall have supervision and direction over the interim prime minister and cabinet, unquote. With all these immense powers, and since the new constitution does not bar him to run, he would therefore be in a perfect position to run in 2022, giving him an unbelievable head start against any opposition in the next presidential elections. Hence, on question 2B, the institutional challenge to protect your democracy is to ban the incumbent president, who is covered by the constitutional ban on re-election under the 1987 constitution, from running as president under the new proposed federal constitutions. Since federalism is being sold by almost all its Filipino proponents as supposedly fulfilling the need for sweeping institutional changes to improve our democracy, I challenge all the proponents of federalism, from the PDP Laban to members of the House of Representatives and the members of the consultative committee formed by President Duterte, to put their institutional design where their mouth is. Write down a provision banning the incumbent president to allay the valid fears of many Filipinos that the shift to federalism is part of the same script of the current president and his key allies to remain in power beyond his constitutionally mandated term limit under the 1987 Constitution. The statement of President Duterte that he will step down in 2022, even if a federal constitution is passed, is as good as his campaign promise to ride the jet ski to the Spratlys, a promise which he now teases his own supporters for believing. To make sure that in 2022, he does not tease the country for believing him in 2018, that he will step down once his term ends under the 1987 Constitution and not run again for president, institutionalize his promise to step down by constitutionally barring him to run in your proposed federal constitutions. Ban Duterte, defend democracy. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Pilapil. In previous hearings, we tried our best to have differing sides speak one after the other. We will have Ms. Sandra Tablan Paredes, Executive Director of the League of Provinces of the Philippines next. Ma'am, you have the floor. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I was designated by Governor Ryan Singson to attend in, on his behalf, our national president, and I will just read the General Assembly resolution passed by the League on this matter of the proposed please, shift of federal.
Please go ahead and give my regards to Governor Ryan. He is my inaanak sa kasal.
Labisto po yung edad nyo.
Oo, medyo may mukha lang akong young looking pero matanda na ako. Go ahead, ma'am. Go ahead.
Thank you. So the League of Provinces of the Philippines passed its J Resolution number 2018-04 adopting our official position paper on the proposed shift from a unitary to a federal form of government through charter change. So the League fully supports the President's call for a federal shift from a unitary to a federal form of government through charter change to accelerate local development equitably and spread the economic gains throughout the country. We believe in its fundamental objective to bring government closer to the people, to be able to immediately address local issues and concerns, and effectively implement programs that will enhance the delivery of basic services to the Filipino people. How? By giving more resources, more power, and responsibilities through charter change to truly make them more effective partners in the attainment of national goals. Why? To ensure a genuine and meaningful local autonomy, making governance more transparent and accountable to the people, since LGUs are at the front line of service delivery. This will relieve the central government of the burden of managing local affairs and enable it to concentrate on national and international issues and concerns. When, 25 years after the enactment of the 1991 Local Government Code, which already transferred most of the functions and responsibilities to LGUs through devolution, the logical next step to fully decentralize is to federalize. As former Senate President Aquilino Nene Pimentel said, federalism is the natural next step after local autonomy. So the LPP has continuously lobbied for the amendment of vital provisions of the 1991 Local Government Code that will, number one, increase the internal revenue allotment and transfer more funds from the national government to local governments for the devolved services. Number two, to ensure genuine fiscal autonomy by leveling the playing field for all LGUs and capacitate them to impose local taxes to augment its revenues, but to no avail. Previous administrations opposed to let go of its fiscal control to LGUs. Hence, the time to change our constitution is now. While President Rodrigo Duterte, a former mayor himself, has the political will, determination, and commitment to bring this much-needed change for our country and people. The provinces, Mr. Chairman, are pro-federalism, but are also deeply concerned of the many ramifications of a sudden shift in the system and structure of government. Hence, we need to determine the roadmap through prior consultations with local governments that will provide a gradual transition that will be to the best interest of the country. An abrupt and rapid change may only result to rushed or hasty policy decisions that may run counter to the very objectives we want to achieve under a federal system of governance. The operative transition will need more time, Mr. Chairman, inasmuch as government, national and local, will have to adopt major fiscal policy changes, foremost of which is to capacitate all stakeholders for the shift in powers, functions and responsibilities from the national to the sub-national levels. Correlated to this is the shift in fiscal policy that will transfer more funds from the central to the local governments and allow the LGUs to participate more significantly in the country's economic development through a more viable contribution to the GDP through an increased share in public spending. In Asia Pacific, the average annual share of its subnational governments in public spending is 34%, which correspondingly yields a higher percentage share in GDP. Based on studies, Mr. Senator, there is a correct direct correlation in this regard.
Can we have that figure again, 30%?
In the Asia Pacific, Mr. Senator, based on a study done by the United Cities Alliance of Local Governments, 34% po yung average in the Asia Pacific region. In China, it's even as high as 84%, pero doon po iba naman yung system of government nila doon.
In the Philippines?
Sadly, we're only 15% share of the public spending of the national government. Actually, the national average po was 16%, but although the ERA increased in amount for the 2017 and 2018 GAA under the Duterte administration, our percentage share has decreased to 16.0. The average is 16.5, and 16% na lang po yung ating share ng governments, local governments in public spending. So, hence, the
more than double, no?
Opo, in Asia Pacific.
I mean, the Asia Pacific average is more than double
that of the Philippines. Yes, correct, Mr. Chairman. Hence, the League is advocating for a fund augmentation reform for local governments to increase the 16.5% annual average of RLGs in the national budget in order to sustain the gradual transition to a federal form of government. As a backgrounder, Mr. Chairman, when we did this, when the League adopted this resolution, we did a simulation of the comparative revenues between under a unitary and under the proposed federal form of government, which I will present later. Okay. To continue with the position.
Go ahead.
So we strongly advocate status quo, wherein all 81 provinces should remain as the autonomous sub-national level or independent states under the general supervision of the duly elected president of the federal government, overseeing all its component cities, municipalities, and barangays. Kasama na rin provinces and highly urbanized cities po ito, Mr. Chairman. So there are 81 provinces, 33 component cities, and 5 independent components for a total of 119 local government units. So you can say, we can say, Mr. Chairman, that this is our 911 of the 119. Apo, ito po yung aming emergency call. Instead of allocating and spending scarce and limited government resources in creating additional layers of bureaucracy for the proposed regional states, we strongly support status quo by allocating said funds directly to the LGUs, meaning the provinces, cities, municipalities, and barangays, for the delivery of basic services. Each province shall be empowered to impose within its territory or jurisdiction taxes, charges, and fees not being imposed by the federal government, and shall determine the administration and distribution of local taxes among the local government units within its jurisdiction. Again, we base this on a simulation we did as to the cost of how much it will cost the country in creating new regional states, Mr. Chairman. In its place, the League supports the strengthening of the existing regional development councils and the special metropolitan political subdivisions as stated by Dr. Magno, or other similar bodies composed of provincial governors and highly urbanized city mayors and representatives from NGOs as created under Section 14 of the 1987 Constitution for purposes of administrative decentralization and inter-LGU coordination to strengthen the authority of the local governments therein and to accelerate the economic and social growth and development of its communities. I think Dr. Chakmanasan has the estimates of which was made the basis of our position paper. Now, during the transition to a federal form of government, we urge the full implementation of the 1991 Local Government Code to ensure genuine local and fiscal autonomy. Hence, the LPP strongly urges the Duterte administration, the Oversight Committee created under Section 533 of Republic Act 7160, and for Congress to exercise its oversight function, the Department of Budget and Management and all other national government agencies, especially those whose functions and responsibilities have already been devolved to the local governments. This is to ensure the full implementation of the provisions of the 1987 Constitution, the Code, the Local Government Code, and its implementing rules and regulations in Administrative Order 270, and also the 1997 National Internal Revenue Code and other laws and Supreme Court jurisprudence in order to attain a genuine local and fiscal autonomy as a means to enhance the LGU powers, functions, and responsibilities and resources of local governments that will result to a gradual increased share of local revenues of all local government units, both from internal and external sources of revenues, including the ERA, through the following. Number one, direct download to LGUs of funds for devolved programs, projects, and services of national government agencies, leading to an actual transfer of funds in the General Appropriations Act, following the strict implementation of Section 17 of Republic Act 7160, which states that regional offices of national agencies or offices whose functions are devolved to local government units as provided herein shall be phased out within 1 year from the approval of this code. Number two,
concretely, that would be DSWD,
agriculture, health.
So, under the local government code,
phase out
DSWD funds, DOH funds, and Department of Agriculture funds should have been downloaded directly to the local governments, and their regional offices should have been phased out
within a year, yes, or 5 years. To affect the but it has not been and a factual statement to that effect would we can glean from the budget of these agencies that it has proportionately increased through time, and in fact the national government share 86% of the funds are being spent by the national government agencies.
86% of the
on the average,
the national budget.
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Is the national government,
yes.
And then that leaves the LGUs 14%.
About that range.
So breadcrumbs.
Opo, para pong inbudo, paghahandahan lang pong nagtitrickle down sa local governments. Kaya po hindi maramdaman ni Juan de la Cruz ang development, kasi po ganun po yung sitwasyon.
Tapos may underspending pa sa 86%.
Yes, 567 billion last year.
Na hindi nagagastos.
Opo, sana po kung nailipat lang po yun sa local governments, nagkaroon po na economic activity sa baba.
Okay, please continue.
Okay. Number two, amend the DBCC Resolution 2003-02 on the determination of the revenue base, which is still based on an old inoperative law, which is Presidential Decree 144 as amended by Presidential Decree 1741, which have already been superseded and specifically repealed under section under the transitory provision of the Republic Act 7160, and also repealed in RA 8424 or the 1987 National Internal Revenue Tax Code, and ensure the rightful computation of the 40% IRA share of LGUs from the National Internal Revenue Collections actually realized as certified by BIR. Hindi po nakalagay as collected by BIR. Nakalagay po sa batas as certified lang by BIR. And not after deducting special funds and special accounts in accordance to existing laws, to include the internal revenue collections of the Bureau of Customs on VAT and excise taxes on imported goods. Malinaw po sa batas, Mr. Chairman, itong BOC collections on VAT and excise taxes on imported goods, it is within the internal revenue taxes. From 1992, hindi po yan sinasama ng BIR sa revenue base. Kaya po 40% of what? 40% of a lower level. And it has resulted, based on our study, we conducted a comprehensive review of the computation of the IRA.
Magkano utang sa inyo?
Ay, naku po, ang laki. On the average po, 31% lang po ang IRA na natatanggap ng local government units, Mr. Chairman. So we really need you, your support, and the Chairman of the Ways and Means Committee and Local Government to hold a sunset review and to exercise it, the oversight function of the committee to tell the BIR to correct this computation. Kasi po, this is our constitutionally mandated fiscal space, Mr. Chairman. So, and we're not saying bayaran na utang agad-agad. Ang sinasabi lang po ng league sa ngayon, prospectively, i-apply na po yung correct computation beginning 2019 para na po hindi makadagdag sa utang.
Would you have, well, off?
Yes, we have, Mr.
Some
Chairman.
Estimate, how much would that be in a year, additional?
Well,
about
100 billion.
I have the file, Mr. Chairman, but...
So you, in other words...
Ang total po, I can say, is one from 1995 to 2017, it's actually 1.234 trillion.
Isn't this a... there's a pending case?
Mr. Chairman, yes. The pending case, the Mandanas case, pending in the Supreme Court right now, and we heard that it will soon be released, no? It only deals with the BOC taxes.
Okay.
But based on previous Supreme Court decisions on the Romulo versus Batangas, nakalagay naman po doon, when the Supreme Court ruled on the illegal unprogrammed funds on the IRA, the court said that they recognized the fact that Congress already removed that provision in the succeeding GAAs, but still the court ruled to have a definitive decision on the matter, and they said that any administrative fiats or executive issuances or amendments of the local government code through the GAA is not permissible. Anything that has a diminution or a shortfall of the IRA is unconstitutional. So there are a plethora of Supreme Court cases already, Mr. Chairman, that behooves our passionate appeal na itama na po itong pag-compute ng IRA ng mga LGUs.
Prospectively,
okay. Yes. And if we may say, Mr. Chairman, this this shortfall of 1.2 trillion, you know, there is already a precedent. Nung dati pong na-IRA cut, may Supreme Court decision din na sabi bayaran ng national government. At binayaran po yon through an IRA monetization program. The Miracle 1 and 2. Yun po kasi yung IRA discrepancy between the GAA IRA at yung actual release ng Bureau of Treasury. So, nagka-shortfall. Ngayon po, Mr. Chairman, hindi lang po mali yung computation ng IRA sa revenue base dahil hindi sinasama ang BOC collection at yung pong special accounts, no, na umabot na po ng 584 billion na mga mining tax, mga tobacco tax na dapat po by law is in addition to the ERA. No, binabawas po yan ng BIR based on that DBCC resolution, which is we think is ultra vires because it cannot amend the law. Oh, so yung pong pag sinabi po ng Supreme Court na bayaran under the Mandanas case, if ever that will be the decision, then national government has no option but to pay. And
the DBCC circular is what year?
2003-02.
Noong panahon na yon,
si Secretary Bongko din pa po.
Tsaka ang panahon na yon, yung budgetary appropriations for infrastructure was only around 200 billion ata.
Opo.
In 2003. Today, it's over almost a trillion.
Yes. And
in other words, noon, walang masasabi nating karampot kasi yung pondo.
Opo.
Kaya naghihigpit. Eh ngayon na because of, you know, our ability to address our fiscal challenges 15 years ago, we're in a very different position today, right?
Well, Mr.
No, meaning, I mean, the overall
yes, we agree.
Fiscal health is
yes.
No longer the same as 2003.
Of course, Mr.
Chairman. Naghihigpit pa yung DBM noon. Ngayon, yeah. Ngayon naghihigpit pa rin kahit na malaki na nga ang pondo.
But the Supreme Court said that no matter how good the intentions are, they should.
Yes, I understand.
Oh.
We will look into that.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Well, and it should also be part. I guess, you know, we will look into how we can include that in our report.
Alam niyo po, Mr. Chairman, we computed, no, kung hindi po nila i-correct this 2019. Magiging 29.7% po yung aming ERA. It's lower than 30%. And under the local government code, in no case should it be less than 30%. But if they will correct it, it will increase to 33%. May improve po siya.
Okay. We will are you done? Can you wind
up? Yes. A few more
yes, please proceed.
Sentences, Mr. Chairman. So number three is the immediate release of the due shares of LGUs from the national wealth. So yung shortfalls po na sinate, hindi po kasama pa yung unreleased shares of LGUs from national wealth and other special laws including the ALGO, no, and other conditional grants such as but not limited to the assistance to LGUs, the CNGP, and similar funds intended for the delivery of basic services. Henceforth, under a federal government, the respective LGU shall be the collecting agent for the national wealth and natural resources collections with obligation to remit the due share of the federal government. And lastly, pagdating lang po sa national wealth, and lastly, to ensure a level playing field, to strike a balance between economic strongholds and those parts that are not so much economically developed by amending the situs of tax and in its place adopt the tax of origin fiscal policy to spread the gains of economic development in the countryside. Mr. Chairman, hindi po masyadong lopsided ang ERA formula distribution. What is lopsided is the tax locally generated taxing powers of LGUs. Just to emphasize our point, based on a study we conducted, no, the five largest LGU earners are Quezon City, Makati, Manila, Pasig, and Taguig for a total of 50.6 billion just in locally generated revenues. And this five is 0.3% of all the provinces, cities, and municipalities. So this 0.3% is collecting 30% of the total locally generated revenues. So 99.7% of our LGUs are doing good with the 70% portion. So yun po ang pinakamalaking change that we want to see the local government units and how to shift the demand from Imperial Manila to the LGUs.
Mr. Chair, sorry. But
if it's related po to the...
Go ahead, Senator Sen President.
I want to emphasize that yung local government code provision on the money portion of it, you know, centers only on collections of the VIR. That is what the local government code provides, collection lang ng VIR. And the formula of dividing the collections is 60-40. 60% gobyerno nasyonal, 40% gobyerno lokal, at yung 40% yun, apat pa ang maghati-hati. Provincia, siyudad, munisipyo at barangay. Now, under the proposed revision by mga shifting to a federal status, our proposal is lahat ng income ng gobyerno, hindi lang collection ng BIR, including from natural resources, all kinds of revenue raised by government should now be shifted to, should now be revised so that 80% of the collections of the government, the total collections of the government, should now be allocated to the federal states and the local governments therein. But Mr. Chairman, I want to emphasize na importante na ang sharing ng federal state and that local government must also be defined. Because otherwise, soluhin ang makapangyarihan yung pera na pupunta roon. So, I just want to make sure that we understand your discussion on the local government today refers only to collections of the VIR, not the other matters, because that's what the local government code provides.
Yes, please.
I cannot debate with that.
So, could you wind up, ma'am?
Yes, Paul.
Go ahead.
So,
thank you.
Lastly, Mr. Chairman, the LPP will actively participate in continued policy dialogues and public hearings regarding the shift. But we strongly reiterate our recommendation that the LPP should have its duly authorized representative to be an official member sana po of the consultative committee under the Office of the President created under Executive Order Number 10 in order to provide the much needed perspective from the local government sector, although andyan naman po si Senator, no? But still, the present circumstances, no? To ensure the best possible revisions of the Constitution under a federal form of government.
Pwede pa bang mabago yun? Because
19 pa lang po.
Mr. Chairman, that's a very good point because as of now, out of the 20 members of the consultative commission, only
25.
Out of 25, 20 lang ang nandyan. Isa lang ang babae. Ano ba yan? Dapat madagdagan ang babae. At ang IPs, Mr. Chairman, only one.
And basic sectors.
From Malaysia. Dapat madagdagan din yun.
Total, basic sectors also. Basic sectors po. IPs,
yeah.
Labor,
yeah, also.
Women. Well, dapat mas maraming babae.
Kasi youth. Nagdidiskurso na po sila. Hindi po kami na eh.
And just as a last point, Mr. Chairman, I want this body to know that my proposal to adopt the federal system is not the PDP Laban proposal. I dissociate myself from PDP at this time of my life. I do not want to be engaged in partisan politics anymore, Mr. Chairman. And so I am proposing a federal system that born out of our studies, but not necessarily based on partisan considerations.
Thank you for that clarification, Senate President Pimentel. So please, we're done. We can...
Yun lang po, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
But the Governor Bichara, our chairman, no, also wants me to emphasize the reason why the governors are not recommending the creation of regional states. And in fact, the President, in his speech in Davao, already said that he is amenable to a hybrid type of a federal form of government or an asymmetrical type We will be having our General Assembly meeting of the governors tomorrow precisely to discuss the hybrid type of government and to extend our support to the this call of the President regarding the immediate passage of the Bangsamoro or the BBL. So the concept lang po, enunciated by Governor Junicua also, we will be having this discussion po ng mga governors tomorrow. And ito po mga questions that you have raised in your committee, although we have not tackled these questions, we will be tackling this tomorrow precisely and present the position of the League.
Yes, please, we would appreciate that, ma'am. So far, there are two proposals for federalism that have been raised in this hearing. The federalism, the federal state as proposed by Senator Pimentel, which he placed on record, 12.
Yes, yes.
12 federal states. Now, the League of Provinces is saying 119 federal entities.
Well, save for the Bangsamoro.
Yes, yes. Yes. In other words,
status quo. Po.
Status quo, yes. Federalized, but instead of the state government, it's provincial, municipal, and city.
You know, we should, Mr. Senator, we really regret that this is not a funny thing, no? This is a serious matter because ang position po ng mga governors ito, and they have had
My understanding is, but this is a transition.
Yes, a transition. Pwede naman po eventually. But the fact is, this is the least disruptive.
Yes.
And the fact that ang objective lang natin is to decentralize, to bring government closer to the people, to regionalize it. It's more of the center.
Yes, yes.
And halos 74 billion po ang magagastos per the estimates of almost 74 billion.
Part of your
but she already presented it to us. But well, we considered that 74 billion is expected to be spent on the personal services MOOE of these regional states. Meron naman po tayo, Mr. Chairman, mga RDCs, no? Na instead po na mapunta sa sweldo, yung pera, idalin po mismo sa mga programa ng RDC. Yung na-identify po ng RDC na priority projects interconnecting the provinces, its component cities, yun po ang pondohan. At diretso na pong ibigay sa mga LGU, yung pera, para po maramdaman ng tao yung servisyo na, kasi kung i-compare po natin ang income ng Makati, 11 billion sa business tax. Ang average lang pong share ng province sa mga municipalities niya, wala pa nga hong share ang province sa component city, is an average of 7 million lang. So, paano po, hindi naman po iba ang servisyong dinidemand ni Juan de la Cruz sa Makati sa servisyong dinidemand ng tao sa Palawan. So, yun po ang punto nila. Na okay. Kaya po, ayaw po nila ng regional states.
Okay, ma'am, ikaw na po ang nag-segue. Before we recognize Dr. Mana, how do we pronounce your name, ma'am? Manasan. Manasan. Yes, Chat Manasan. We just would like to place on record and acknowledge the presence of former Senator Joey Lina. Senator, thank you for joining us. So, ma'am, you have the floor for your presentation.
I have a short presentation. I think it will exceed the 7 minutes allotted.
We will give you the time that you need, ma'am.
It's about 15 minutes at the very least. Yes,
please proceed.
Yeah. So, these are the set of questions that I'm trying to answer next, please.
To adopt the federal system or not, why? If so, how?
If yes, how?
Yes.
Next, please. These are the questions I will try to answer in this presentation. Why adopt a federal system of government? What are the potential benefits from doing so? How to secure said benefits? And this will talk about the design what are the risks in adopting a federal system and then a way forward? Why adopt a federal system? The fiscal federalism framework, which is as a branch of economics that is concerned with the division of powers between different levels of government and intergovernmental fiscal relations, point out that there are in fact several benefits from adopting that can be secured by adopting a federal system of government. First, increased efficiency and welfare to the extent that subnational governments, being closer to the people, are better able to respond to the needs and preferences of local constituents. Enhance accountability to the extent that subnational governments have some degree of revenue autonomy, meaning they raise part of their own taxes so that their constituents demand the services that they deserve, given the taxes that they pay, and that it's a means of addressing ethnocultural conflict as it accommodates regional diversity. Next, please. The first two of these potential gains are largely a function of the extent of decentralization as per the fiscal federalism framework. Said gains may be secured with greater fiscal decentralization, with or without a shift to a federal system of government. Countries with federal systems of government are not necessarily decentralized to the same degree, and some of them may be less decentralized than those with a unitary system like ours. Germany, which is federal, is more centralized than Canada, which is federal. Malaysia, which is federal, is said to be more centralized than Indonesia, which is unitary. Next, please. Now, what is really the distinction between a unitary multi-chaired system and a federal system of government? Under the multi-chaired unitary system, which is what we have at present, the powers of the subnational governments are based on central government legislation. That means delegated by the central government and can be unilaterally withdrawn by the central government. Under a federal system, the division of powers between the federal government and the state governments are written and guaranteed in the Constitution. The federal government and the state governments cannot unilaterally alter the division of powers. And precisely because of this, the design of the federal system should be subject to careful study, otherwise bad design gets enshrined in the Constitution. Now, I want to emphasize this, that under a real federal system, the division of powers are written and guaranteed in the Constitution, because some of the draft constitutions that have been offered today, the guarantee is not there. If the objective, therefore, is to secure the potential benefits from more decentralized governance, the principles that guide the design of the fiscal aspects of the federal system of government are just as relevant for reforming decentralized governance in a unitary form of government. So, yung principles that I will discuss a little later in designing the fiscal aspects, and what I mean, and I will define also what the fiscal aspects are, they are applicable to the design of a federal system as well as to the design of a more decentralized unitary system. These principles are aimed at ensuring that the federal government or the central government and subnational governments face the right incentives for an efficient and equitable delivery of public services so as to maximize social development outcomes. Now, what do I mean by fiscal aspects? According to the fiscal federalism framework, it consists of four pillars. The expenditure assignment, which is which level of government does what. The tax assignment, which talks about which level of government taxes what. intergovernmental transfer, subnational credit finance, meaning access of subnational governments to the credit and capital market. The design of the four pillars, in a sense, defines the rules of the game, i.e., they are institutions that affect the behavior of politicians at both national and local level, as well as the behavior of voters. Now, what are the overarching design principles when looking at the fiscal features? This part of the presentation will be very, very, in a sense, oversimplified, because to discuss it would involve more time than I will have for today. The first one is the importance of establishing clarity in expenditure assignment. And this is which level of government does what. The first rule is that functions whose benefits are national in scope are best assigned to the federal government. Foreign affairs, national defense are, of course, federal functions. Those whose benefits are local in scope are best assigned to subnational governments, possibly agricultural extension,
health,
but not public health, which has externalities, meaning like immunization. You cannot fully say that immunizations should be purely local, because there are benefits that extend beyond the jurisdiction. If you do not immunize everybody in your jurisdiction, pati yung kapitbahay mo, munisipyo, magkakaroon ng measles, for instance.
So, palipat-lipat.
Communicable disease. But hospitals, tertiary care, those are local in scope. But beyond, you know, what functions is clarity. Because many times analyze the proposed constitution, there is lack of clarity. Okay. With regards to revenue assignment, one of the principles is that taxes on immobile factors, yung hindi nakakalipat-lipat, real property, are best assigned to subnational governments. User charges, meaning fee for service provided, are best assigned to subnational governments. But taxes that interfere on international trade and interjurisdictional trade are best assigned to FG, meaning you don't want subnational governments taxing the movement of products across regions. Otherwise, there will be a very chaotic common market, or there will be no common market in the nation.
Parang yung extortion. Mula sa Baguio hanggang Manila, kanya-kanyang tax yun, di ba?
Then that will be very distortionary and lead to a very non-competitive Philippines. Number three, next please. Intergovernmental transfers may be used to address imbalances between the resource requirements of functions assigned to different levels of government and the resources that are actually assigned to them. Meaning, very often, yung guidance that we get in terms of expenditure assignment, mas madaling mag-decentralize ng function kesa mag-decentralize ng revenues for some reason. So, kailangan mo ng transfers or revenue sharing to some extent. At the same time, you need transfers because there are wide disparities in the fiscal capacities of subnational governments vis-a-vis each other. And this is very evident when we look at gross regional domestic product per capita or per capita household income across regions. In terms of gross regional domestic product, 62% of gross regional domestic product is captured by NCR 3 and 4A.
So in other words, all the resources are there.
And that's the tax base. So no matter what
taxing powers... And the question therefore is, since it's all 62% is all in these three regions, how do... You must have some transfer.
to the poorer regions.
And how is that done?
Through what is called an equalization grant.
So that has to be part of a federalism design.
Yeah, exactly. Otherwise, the existing disparities will become even wider across region.
And you're also saying that this is not clear in the debates and the proposals.
In the proposals, some proposals would have this nominally, but when they try to articulate it in more definitive terms, then it becomes confusing.
For example, Senator Nene Pimentel said earlier 80% should be plowed back. How does that work, for example, with 62% of the revenue being in three regions, and then now you're saying the federal states and the local governments should now share 80% of the revenue?
The 80%, I would say, is a question that relates more to what I call internal consistency. You have to be clear about what functions you are devolving further relative to the sharing. For instance, if you say, I will retain basic education at the central level, definitely 80% of the subnational governments will not work, because education by itself is even bigger than the 20% of the budget. So it all depends. The precise number in terms of revenue sharing will depend on the specific division of powers. And it's very difficult to say in advance what that percentage should be without knowing what the division of powers
may
exactly.
I just
yes, please. Yes, yes, so that we can have a better understanding of what is being proposed.
I think it should be fully understood that our proposal, or anyway, my proposal to adopt the federal system would reduce the powers that are, you might say, to be exercised by the central federal government. Mainly to matters of national security.
National defense,
meaning to say one armed forces, and that will answer a portion of your question earlier, Mr. Chairman, on the proliferation of political dynasties and warlords, because under my proposal, there shall only be one armed forces that will be authorized to exist in this republic. No other, whether you are a governor or an influential person in any of the proposed regions, no, you will not be allowed to organize a private army of your own. Only one armed forces will be authorized under the proposed revision of our constitution. Secondly, only one national police for purposes of implementing the national laws on crime, and then one of the advantages of having one national police is that a criminal, let us say in the federal state of Mindoro, Palawan, Romblon, etc., cannot fly to Isabela and say, well, I am now in a new federal state, hindi mo na ako pwedeng ulitin. No, sir, because one national police will have that authority to run after you for violating a national law. The local police will only be empowered to enforce federal law legislation on crime. Now, additionally, there shall only be one monetary system, so that there will be no difference between your money here in Manila and our money in Mindanao. And then one curriculum for our public schools, Mr. Chairman, because otherwise if we have multi-curricula, you are Taga Mindoro ka, you have a 2-year-old child, you're gonna transfer to Manila and expect your child to be admitted at the same level kung iba yung curriculum dito. And then, of course, the most important thing, Mr. Chairman, is this. Incidentally, we should only have one flag, unlike the US na maraming bandera, only one national flag for the symbol of the unity of our people. And then, in other words, the investment policies of this country, Mr. Chairman, should be devolved to federal states. So they will decide what is best for the development of their peoples without having to ask permission from NEDA. Because they would know best what is suited for the faster development of their people and the kind of incentives that they would give. Hindi na kailangan humingi pa ng paintulot sa Maynila. So, in other words, limited na ang powers ng gobyerno nasyonal. That is why, kukunti na rin lang ang suggestion natin ng pera na pupunta sa gobyerno nasyonal. Because their powers would now be limited. But as the lady has been suggesting, dapat define ito, maliwanag, para hindi maguluhan ang tao bayan.
Thank you, thank you. Please continue, Dr. Chat.
Kung paano i-define yung division ng powers, dapat kasunod din yung pera. At nagtutugma. I think that's what I really want to emphasize. On the number four, importante po na subnational governments are able to borrow from the capital and credit market. Because otherwise, those that are credit worthy among them will not be able to finance lumpy investments kung kailangan pa nilang ipunin yung pera nila bago sila makapagpagawa ng, say, malaking infrastructure projects. But having said that, importante din that there is a commitment on the part of the federal government not to bail out fiscally distressed subnational governments. And this is very important if we look at the experience of many Latin American countries in the 1990s, Brazil, Argentina, Venezuela, where their governments naging bangkarote because of excessive borrowings of their subnational state governments, in fact, because those countries are federal, dahil binail out nung federal government, yung mga utang nung subnational governments. And I have talked about internal consistency, coherence amongst the four pillars. Otherwise, pwedeng madami yung inassign mong functions, kulang ng pera, or konti yung marami kang binigay na pera, konti yung functions. Next, this is just a table on the wide disparities. Let me skip that. Now, let me talk about the shift to a federal form of government coming at a cost. And when we estimate this cost, ito well-cited, daming beses kinokote ng mga tao, and many are questioning, what are the elements of this cost? The elements of this cost are salaries of governors, vice governors of state governments and their staff, as well as their operating expense of their offices. So we're assuming here there's a middle level government above the LGUs and below the federal government. So there are state governments or regional governments, if you want to call them regional governments. Then the salaries of senators of the second chamber, which is an essential feature of all federal system. There is a second chamber where there is regional representation. Again, salaries of senators, their staff, as well as operating expense of their office. Operating expense, in the words of the budget, MOOE po. Okay, hindi po ito investment. Salaries of the judiciary, somebody said, I should cost this, pero hindi ko po na-cost ito dahil hindi. Sa lahat ng proposals na nabasa ko, hindi pa klaro sa ngayon kung anong itsura ng judiciary. Magdadagdag ba sila ng courts at the regional level? That is so uncertain, so that has not been included in the estimate. It also included the salaries of state legislators and their staff, as well as the operating expense of their offices. For instance, under the PDP Laban draft constitution, this is version 1, what they call PDP Laban version 1, 0.0 under the interim, during the interim period, there will be three state legislators from each LGU comprising the regional government, and then after the enactment of the Organic Act, two from each province and one from each city. There are of course other models, depending kung gagayahin natin yung nasa RA 9054, yung proposal ni Senator Nene sometime back, which I think you will have a total of 1,356. The BBL model, you will have at least 10 legislators. So iba-ibang configuration. Bottom line estimate of the additional fiscal burden, anywhere from 44 to 72 billion, depending on the number of states. Incidentally here, hindi 12 ang aking basis, 17.
17 federal, 17 state governments.
State governments.
Okay.
With different configurations as to the number of legislators and size of legislative body. Note these estimates, I want to emphasize, these estimates do not include the cost of the regional operations of departments that will prospectively be devolved. Meaning, kung sinabi natin na ang DA, mawawala na ang DA as we know it now, and instead, magiging fully devolved yung function ng DA to the regional governments.
Wala pa yun.
Ang assumption natin is yung regional offices nila mapupunta lang sa regional government at the same cost.
Mm-hmm.
But not additional cost to the entire government. So ito, yung sinasabi natin na 44 to 72 billion, this is just the incremental cost of the bureaucracy. Additional talaga ito. But cost aside, now I want to talk about some of the risks in adopting a federal system of government. One is getting the design right. I have talked about the principles of designing the fiscal aspects. So hindi ko na uulitin yan. But what I want to point out is that having looked at two of the draft constitutions that are out there more very closely, one of them is even less decentralized than the present system. That same draft constitution is not only less decentralized, but provides for a lot of ambiguity and is almost not like a federal constitution in the sense that there is no constitutional guarantee or very little constitutional guarantee. Because, for instance, there will be provisions that says the division of powers is contingent on the prime minister saying that regional governments have the financial capacity, have the technical capacity. So everything is contingent on action of the federal government, either the prime minister or the federal assembly. The other constitution, while appearing to be draft constitution, while appearing to be more decentralized, also introduces a lot of ambiguity. So may mga issues na ganon. Next risk is even if, and we're saying if you don't design it right, you don't get the benefits.
This is in relation to what you said earlier, that in other governments, federal governments, there are written and guaranteed in the constitution.
So
the division of powers.
Oh, meaning nakalista talaga, what are the exclusive powers of the federal, what are the exclusive powers of the state.
And all the proposals thus far have yet to define in
at least one of them very, very unclear. In fact, sasabihin niya, these are the exclusive powers of the federal and then exclusive powers of the regional. But then in another section would say, but provided that it can be expanded or reduced depending on actions of the Prime Minister or actions of the Federal Assembly. In other words, still requiring legislation. So my question is, if that's a truly federal constitution, then the guarantee should be more definitive.
May we respond?
Yes, please. Go ahead, sir.
Chairman. No. Probably what we can do is to adapt the Malaysian model, because their constitution actually has three layers of powers. One, the first layer reserved to the national government, the national federal government. The second layer reserved to the federal states. The third layer, common to both.
Sure.
Kung sino mauna, irrespeto ng nahuli. So, in other words, that might be a possible, solution to the problem raised by the lady.
And in other constitutions, they have indeed what they call shared powers or concurrent powers with well-defined principles of sharing the power.
Please proceed.
Now, the second risk, okay, so assuming we get the design right, the second risk, I think, arises from, even if you have the initial design of the federal model right at the start, so you have a consultative commission, committee, for instance, that proposes and the design is perfect, the likelihood is still there, in fact, I say it's high, that the initial model will be changed to reflect the particular interests of the actual framers of the new constitution. And this brings us to the question of CONAS and CONCOM. There is a study by the World Bank which says, this is done in 2001, and the reference point is, bakit nga ba hindi ma-amend ang local government code? The point raised is that Congress as an institution is not likely to be inclined to expand the resource base of LGUs. Why? Because legislators, particularly those in Congress, see governors, mayors, especially the mayors of the highly urbanized city, as rivals, political rivals. So ayaw nila talagang bigyan ng real power in terms of resources. And that's the political economy analysis of that problem. So the point is, kung tunay, if that is true.
All right, so we're going to cut in. We've been listening to resource persons presenting during the hearing of the Senate Committee on Constitutional Amendments and Revision of Codes and Laws. Lawmakers are considering proposals to amend or revise the 1987 Philippine Constitution as they consider the country's shift to a federal form of government. We heard from former Senator Nene Pimentel. He's widely considered as the father of local government code. He mentioned his proposal to create 12 federal states that include disputed territories and exclusive economic zones. He also referred to the consultative committee's vote to regulate political dynasties, and as well as the consultative committee report, which is expected to be submitted before the President Sona in July. Several resource persons spoke today. Just a quick recap of what they said. Dr. Francisco Magno of De La Salle had said that LGUs should foster equitable and inclusive growth, while the government should relax restrictions on foreign ownership to boost competitiveness. And we're going to leave it at that for now. We'll have some stories on this in future newscasts, but let's go ahead to Malacañang, which is holding a press conference.
Asian activities, no? Another good news, the Philippines has been recognized as among the top 10 awardees in five categories of the 11th cycle of the Dubai International Award for Best Practices to Improve the Living Environment. Specifically, the United Nations Habitat and Dubai Municipality granted the Philippines with university research grants on legislation, rules, regulations, and governance systems, which cited the country's efforts in making land climate sensitive. The award is given to different sectors in national and regional governments, local authorities and their associations, non-governmental organizations, community-based organizations, research and academic institutions, public and private foundations, and individuals taking steps to further the adaptation of the UN Habitat's new urban agenda, a roadmap to make sustainable cities for all. Another good news, the government through the Intellectual Property Office of the Philippines continues to intensify campaign against selling and buying of counterfeit products. The IPOPHL reported that various agencies of the National Committee on Intellectual Property Rights were able to seize 8.2 billion worth of counterfeit and pirated goods in 2017, a 26% in 2016, and is considered the biggest haul since 2014. The agency with the largest seized goods in 2017 is the Bureau of Customs with more than 5.8 billion. On the dismissal of the case against Peter Lim and Kerwin Espinosa, we would like to assure the public that the dismissal is far from being final. It is in fact subject to automatic review by Secretary Vitaliano Aguirre, and we look forward to the review to be made by Secretary Aguirre. Meanwhile, we understand the sentiments and the frustration of the public over the dismissal, but stress that the police can refile the case, can introduce additional evidence, but we need to be very careful that at this stage that the evidence would be complete to sustain a conviction when filed before the courts. The DOJ petition, as assured to the public, will not affect the case of Senator Laila De Lima. There are other witnesses who will testify against the lady senator. Questions?
Rose Novenario.
Hi, sir. Good morning.
Hi, Rose.
Sir, sa dismissal lang po nung case ni Peter Lim at saka ni Espinosa. Sir, hindi naisubmit po kaya ng PNP yung transcript po ng Senate investigation po kay Espinosa dahil inamin po roon ni Espinosa na siya ay drug lord. At saka yung ama po niya, bago namatay, inamin po na drug lord din po yung anak niya.
Gaya ng sinabi ko po, no, inaasahan namin na rerepasuhin po ni Secretary Aguirre itong dismissal neto. At kung kinakailangan, magre-refile po ng meron pang mga ebidensya na isasama. No? Kasama po yung admission na sinabi niyo. Tama po kayo, napanood ko po na inamin po yan ni Kerwin dun sa Senado.
Palagay po ba ninyo ay sinadya ito ng PNP na maging parang pabaya sa kanilang tungkulin sa pagsasampa ng kaso sa ganito pong kalalaking drug personalities?
Hindi naman po siguro, at gaya po ng taong bayan, no, ang Office of the President will take a very interested position in this case, and we will closely monitor how the police will act from hence on. No? As I said, if upon review the DOJ finds reasons to reverse the dismissal, then it will be reversed. No? If, however, it is necessary to file additional evidence, we will prompt police authorities to do so. We will not allow a big fish to go away if there's evidence to go after him.
Sir, ano po yung assurance ng palasyo na hindi na po mauulit yung ganitong insidente?
Well, kinakailangan po talaga, no, na bantayan, lalong-lalo na yung mga kaso laban sa mga malalaking personalidad. No? At nagpapasalamat naman kami sa vigilance ng publiko, no, at naisawalat ito. No? Di umano, matagal na pala itong dismissal, no, pero ngayon lang naisawalat sa publiko. No? So, pasalamat din po tayo na may mga nagbabantay.
May ulat po ba si Secretary Aguirre kung bakit po inilihim ito sa publiko?
Wala pa po. No? In fact, unfortunately, before the briefing, Yusek Balmes, a spokesperson of DOJ, just called me. He was the one who just called me. Unfortunately, I'm not able to answer his call anymore. No? But I was assured that this is far from being case closed. We will review the decision, and if need be, we will refile with additional evidence.
Thank you po.
Okay, follow up. Henry Uri. Microphone. Pia, paabot ng microphone.
Magandang tanghali, Secretary.
Magandang tanghali, Henry.
Hindi ho ba ito ay tila sampal sa palasyo sapagkat alam naman natin ang ating Pangulo ang unang-unang galit na galit sa droga? Pero bakit ho may pinag-uusapan tayong halos ay ipapatay na, at sinasabi nga ng Pangulo na talagang kamatayan ang, in fact, maraming beses niyang sinasabi na ayaw niya sa droga, papatayin niya ang mga sangkot sa droga. Pero yung nuno palahon ng transaksyones ng droga sa Bilibid at itong si Kerwin Espinosa ay mahina pa lang ebidensya. Pero sa kabila ng mahina yung ebidensya laban kay Kerwin, ang dami na hong mga namamatay na sangkot sa droga. Paano po ninyo haharapin ngayon ang sinasabi ng ating mga kababayan na pag kaming maliliit ang sangkot sa droga, wala na kaming panahon para magpaliwanag. Marami sa amin ay namamatay. Pero itong mga malalaking taong ito, ay ngayon ay naririto at pinag-uusapan natin ay mahina pala ang ebidensya laban sa kanila.
Ulitin ko po, hindi pa po tapos ang boxing laban kay Peter Lim at dito kay Kerwin Espinosa. Rerepasuhin pa po yan ng kalihim ng Secretary of Justice at sisiguruduhin na tama ang naging naunang desisyon ng ating mga public prosecutors. Mahirap po talaga magsalita kung ano naging basihan ng mga public prosecutors dahil ako mismo hindi ko pa nababasa yung kanilang desisyon. Pero ang pangako po na ating presidente, kung kulang ang ebidensya, dadagdagan, at kung merong kababalaghan, parurusahan naman ang mga responsable. No? So wag po kayong maabala. Siguro naman po, walang kaduda-duda na seryoso ating presidente dito sa gera laban sa droga. At itong kaso pong ito, ang dismissal, uulitin ko po, hindi pa po tapos ang boxing.
Wala ho bang naaamoy na sabwatan sa pagitan ng kung sino man ang palasyo sa bagay na ito?
Kung meron man po, kilala niyo po ang presidente, sibak ang magiging kasagutan dyan. Pero hayaan niyo muna na repasuhin ng ating kalihim ng Department of Justice yan dahil automatic review naman po yan.
May plano bang ipatawag ng Pangulo ang DOJ Secretary, ang Prosecution Service ng DOJ at ang mga kinatawan ng PNP?
Well, gaya na aking sinabi, no, nag-ring po yung telepono ko si Yusek Balmes. Di ko po alam kung anong pinaparating ni Yusek Balmes sa palasyo ngayon. No? Pero needless to say, ito po isang bagay na pag-uusapan ng palasyo at ng DOJ.
Alright, salamat po.
Okay, follow up. Belia Carriazo.
Sir, good morning. Sir, alam naman natin na si Kerwin Espinosa and yung sa mga yung iba pang mga drug personalities na kasama doon sa mga dinismisang case ay kinukuha bilang testigo against Senator De Lima. Hindi ba part ito ng concession dahil nga sa magiging testigo sila against De Lima?
Alam niyo kung yung pagbibigay lang na immunity ang pag-uusapan, hindi na kinakailangan ma-dismiss ang kaso kasi po pwede na sila mabigyan ng immunity. So sa akin po wala namang kinalaman 'yon, no. Ang importante lang masiguro na itong desisyon na pagdi-dismiss ay nakabase po sa ebidensya at kung hindi gagawa po ng hakbang ang otoridad para matuloy ang kaso.
Sir, yung kay Peter Lim, sir, alam naman natin na nang lahat na kumpadre siya sa kasal. So hindi ba naging ano to, naging malambot yung DOJ dahil nga may connection si Peter Lim kay Pangulong Duterte?
Alam niyo po, unfair naman yun na palbasa naging kumbadre sa kasal. No? Lahat po na siguro mga nanunungkulan sa gobyerno, napakadaming kasal na pinupuntahan at hindi naman nakakapili, no, kung sino magiging kumbadre. Nagde-decision po ay yung mga kinakasal. No? So sa akin po, wala namang basihan yung ganyang paratang at hayaan na muna natin umusad ang proseso dyan sa DOJ. No? At titignan din natin ang ebidensya, no, kung tayo nga ay sasangguni din dun sa mga naging desisyon ng public prosecutors at kung talagang mahina ang ebidensya, titignan kung paano po ito mapapalakas, no. So ulitin ko po, hindi pa tapos ang usaping ito. Hindi po pwede na ang isang malaking isda ay hindi mapaparusahan kung merong ebidensya. So tignan po natin ang ebidensya.
Okay, Joanna.
Yes, hi, good PM Secretary.
Yes.
Sir, I would just like to get Pala's reaction in line with the DOJ's dismissal of the drug grabs against the alleged drug lords. Sabi po ni Senator Trillanes po na the Duterte administration's anti-illegal drug campaign is a fake drug war. Sabi po niya, the DOJ's exoneration of these known drug lords is yet another proof that what Duterte unleashed upon us is a fake drug war. Kapag mahirap, walang tanong-tanong, patay kagad. Kapag drug lords at kumpare pa ni Duterte, may due process na absuelto pa sa kaso. What can you say about it?
Pinagsasamantalahan lang po yan ni Senator Trillanes bilang isang politiko. Pero ang gaya ng sinabi ko po kanina, hindi pa po tapos ang boxing. Huwag po tayo magkaroon ng conclusion dahil meron pang proseso na pag-aapila. Wala pa pong pinal na desisyon kung kakasuhan o hindi si Peter Lim. So yung mga ganyang mga salita po ay yan po ay mga salitang politiko.
Okay, Raymond?
Pero sir, hindi ba kayo nababahala na parang yung ruling o decision ng NPS ay parang pinapalabas na mali yung intelligence report na nakuha ng Pangulo dahil it, I understand itong si Kerwin Espinosa and Peter Lim ay kasama siya sa drug list na verified by inter-agencies na sila ay sangkot sa drugs.
Binibigyan ko po ng kumpirmasyon na nababahala kami sa pagbabasura ng reklamo, no? Pero gaya na aking sinabi, hindi naman namin alam kung anong basihan ng mga piskal kung bakit binasura yan at hindi pa tapos ang proseso ng pagre-review. Siguro sapat na na naparating natin sa DOJ na nababahala ang Malacañang sa ganitong desisyon at dahil dito po, eh, talagang masusi nilang pag-aaralan, no? Kung dapat bang dagdagan o dapat baliktarin yung naging desisyon ng investigating panel.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, Laila, follow up?
Hindi naman po kakaiba na po pwedeng mabaliktad yan. No? Kung maalala nyo, yung tumayo akong abogado kay Jerry Ortega, unang decision din, eh, ma-dismiss. No? At yan naman po ay naisampa din.
Sir, clarification lang. Since it was the president who pinned down Peter Lim, does this mean the palace won't accept any ruling other than indictment?
Nako, hindi po. Basta ang sinasabi ko nga po, dapat nakabase yan sa ebidensya. At tiwala kami sa magiging pag-aaral at pagre-repaso ng ebidensya na gagawin ni Secretary Vitaliano Aguirre.
Sir, given the findings of the prosecutor, do you think there's now reason to review the basis of the president's drug list?
I think that's premature because as I said, we don't know what the final decision will be. That's not yet the final decision.
Last on illegal drugs.
Sir, good afternoon po ulit. Sir, napag-usapan na po ba ni Presidente at saka ni Secretary Aguirre tungkol po dyan sa desisyon na yan?
Hindi po, kasi nalaman lang namin to ngayong umaga. Magkakasama po kami hanggang alas 12 ng gabi, midnight as of last night. No? Kasama po namin si Secretary Aguirre, si Soljan Kalida, si Executive Secretary, at si Secretary Bonggo. No? At wala pa po kami ganitong balita as of 12 midnight last night.
So, ultimo po si Secretary Aguirre, sa palagay po ninyo, eh, walang alam po dito? Inilihim din sa kanya?
Hindi ko po alam. It's just that it was not discussed yesterday in a meeting that lasted till midnight.
Okay. Rosa Licos?
Secretary, good morning po. Sa initial assessment nyo po, sa tingin nyo po merong kapabayaan yung prosecution kasi hindi sila naghanap ng matibay na ebidensya. Sabi din po ni Senator Grace po, lalo na malaking isda nga po ito na isinasangkot sa illegal na droga, tungkulin ng prosecution na maghanap ng matibay na ebidensya laban sa kanila.
Well, siguro from a purely academic point of view, no? Ang isang kahinahan po ng ating criminal justice system ay yung mga piskalya palibasa silang umuupo na nagde-determine ng probable cause, no, maintains na trabaho ng pulis kumalap ng ebidensya. Kung ikukumpira niyo po ito sa Amerika, ang pulis at ang public prosecutor sa Amerika nag-uugnayan para po magkaroon ng case build-up bago sila magsimula ng isang grand jury proceedings, no, yung tinatawag na investigation nga kung mayroong probable cause. No? So sa akin po, ang solusyon dyan, dapat merong hiwalay na piskal na nakikipag-ugnayan sa mga kapulisan sa case build-up at hiwalay yung gagawa ng desisyon kung may probable cause. Itong desisyon po ito, ginawa ng mga piskal acting as quasi-judicial officials, no, determining probable cause. No? Pero hindi ibig sabihin na hindi kailangan na isang piskal din ang makipag-ugnayan sa pulis dahil ang mga piskal naman ang alam kung anong kinakailangang ebidensya na makakatayo sa hukuman. No? So anyway, that's an academic answer. No? Under our current system, it is the police that files the complaints and unfortunately, yung task ng prosecuting, yung investigating prosecutors does not include assisting the police in the case build-up. But we will see if reforms can be made so that another branch of the National Prosecution Service can work with the police in case build-ups.
Okay, last two sa illegal drugs, Deo. Microphone, thank you, Pia.
Magandang tanghali, Secretary. If I'm not mistaken, sir, sinabi niyo po kanina na hindi po ito makaka-apekto doon sa kaso ni Senator De Lima. Yes, sir. Eh, paano nyo po nasabi na hindi ito makaka-apekto doon sa kaso ng ni Senator De Lima? Pero parang yun din po ang basis kasi kung bakit siya nakakulong ngayon.
Well, una-una, hindi ko po nababasa pa kung ano yung decision talaga. Na nakita ko lang yung balita na basura nga itong complaint laban sa kanila, no? Pangalawa, hindi naman po kasama dito sa kasong ito si Laila De Lima. So iba po ang basihan ng pagsampa kay kaso kay Laila De Lima, iba ang basihan sa pagsampa ng kaso dito kay Peter Lim.
Sa tingin niyo po, following this, po pwede rin po bang mangyari doon sa kaso ni Senator De Lima yung nangyari doon sa kaso nila?
Hindi po, kasi nakarating na sa Korte Suprema, may probable cause against Laila De Lima. Dito pong kasong ito, ang sabi lang ng DOJ, walang probable cause. Pero yung kay Laila De Lima po, hindi lang RTC nagsabi na may probable cause, pati na po ang judikatura ay nagsabi na may probable cause.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, last. Rose.
Isa na lang po, sir. Sir, palagay po ba ninyo, napapanahon na mag-conduct ng lifestyle check po sa mga prosecutors, lalo na po yung mga humahawak ng drug cases?
Well, gaya na akin sinabi, that's premature naman. No? Tignan muna natin kung ano magiging finding ni Secretary Vitagire. Pero kung Secretary Vitagire determines that there was ample evidence to sustain a finding of probable cause, then perhaps wala tayong ibang option but to conclude, no? Na baka nga, no? I'd like to acknowledge Secretary Sal Panelo. Secretary Panelo, would you like to join me? Ha? Meron ka bang i-announce? Ha? I know.
Okay,
walang tatalo sa pagkagwapo mo, Secretary Sal. Yes, please.
Other issue, Dexter Ganibe.
Hi, Sec. Magandang hapon. Sec, kahapon sa briefing ng spokesperson ng Chinese Foreign Ministry, si spokesperson Lu Yong, sinabi, natanong sa kanya yung issue kaugnay dun sa statement ng Office of the sa Commissioner ng Human Rights kaugnay sa Pangulo. And then, dinepensa niya yung si President Duterte dun sa mga banat niya sa UN. At yung banat ng UN laban kay Pangulong Duterte. Yung ganung statement from China, is it expected from them na dahil malapit ang pangulo sa China, or is it a surprise from
I think
from the
no, I think that would be the correct response of any member state of the United Nations. I reiterate, the United Nations is an organization consisting of states. And as such, all UN officials cannot deal with elected leaders of member nations in a manner that the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights did.
Isa sa binanggit niya, basahin ko lang yung kanyang part ng kanyang naging statement, si spokesperson Lu Yong. Sinasabi niya na UN should support the Philippines to promote its own human rights cause in accordance with its own national conditions. Sabi niya, work hard as a UN agency, Office of High Commissioner of the Human Rights, should perform its duties within the framework of adherence to the purpose and principles of the UN Charter.
That basically should be the correct stand of all states. Tama po yung naging kadugunan ng China, at ito po ay hindi lamang dahil kaibigan natin ng China, because that is really the objectives of the United Nations. No? So all officials of the United Nations must in fact discharge their functions towards realizing the about goals of the UN system and should not resort to abusing, no, and disrespecting elected heads of states of UN member states.
Okay. Other issue, Sec, tinanggap ba ng Pangulo yung resignation ni National Youth Commission Chairperson Isa Siguero?
Wala pa po akong alam tungkol dyan. What I do know is that the Office of the Executive Secretary has received the resignation of Chairperson Isa Siguero.
Raymond Tinasa. Follow-up. Sino na? Raymond. Raymond, ikaw
sir,
na.
Sundot lang. So what's the stand, if any, ng Executive Department dun sa move sa House na again, i-postpone yung SK and barangay elections?
Sinabi na po yan ni Presidente, no? He defers to the wisdom of Congress in this regard. He has expressed a preference na sana matuloy, but if Congress so decides, then he will respect the decision to postpone it anew. Now, I understand yung developments po are in the House, and I'm not sure if there is any development at all in the Senate.
Okay. Follow up?
Secretary, magandang hapon po. Pinatawag daw ng Pangulo ang Senate President and House Speaker ngayong araw sa Malacanang. Dahil po ba ito sa sa eleksyon ng barangay?
Hindi po. I think the topic is about Mindanao.
Sir, doon kay Aiza po, ano po ang reason niya? Bakit daw po nag-resign si Aiza?
Hindi ko pa po nakakausap si Chairperson Siguera. Ang kumpirmasyon na mabibigay ko lang is nakarating na po sa opisina ng ating presidente yung kanyang resignation.
Other issue? Follow up, Bong? I'm sorry. Deo.
Sir, sinabi niyo po kanina. Sir, sinabi niyo po kanina, pinatawag po ni President ang Senate President and House Speaker about Mindanao. Ano pong pag-uusapan nila about Mindanao?
Hindi po ako masyado, hindi ko po sigurado kasi it's not even in the schedule for the day, no? Pero nabanggit lang po yan sa aming pagpupulong kahapon na magkakaroon nga po daw ng meeting with congressional leaders and this is about Mindanao. I suppose it might be related also to BBL, no? And the need to enact BBL as soon as possible. But, you know, the only thing I was told was it was about Mindanao.
Yes, sir. Another question po. Sir, meron pong joint command conference mamaya with the President ang AFP and PNP. Meron po ba tayong mga aasahan na nakalatag na pag-uusapan doon?
Napakahaba po niya mga command conferences na yan, no? But it always begins with the police and the military giving their latest report to the president on the peace and order situation in the country. So magsisimula yan po doon sa briefing na gagawin nila.
Kasama po kaya doon yung ano kay kina Kerwin starting sa PNP?
Well, I will try po na to ask someone to discuss it, no? Pero I suppose it might be discussed po. Napakahaba po kasi niyang mga command conference na yan, no? And I foresee that because this is the news for today, it might be discussed.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, last two na tayo. Alvin Baltazar, then Pia Gutierrez.
Secretary, magandang umaga po. Sir, sabi po ni DILG USEC Martin Dindio, merong 90,000 barangay captains na involved sa illegal drugs. Sir, kung matutuloy ang eleksyon, whether October or masususpend siya ng May at matutuloy sa October. Sir, may plano ba ang palas na isa-publico ito sa mamamayan bago yung eleksyon?
I suppose because the DILG has asked and the President has also asked the electorate to reject barangay officials who are somehow involved in drugs. No? So that possibility is very strong.
Okay. Pia Gutierrez.
Sir, update lang po. Has the President chosen a new chairman for the SEC and the SSS?
Wala pa po. In any case, as soon as there is an appointment, you're the first to know. We post it in our webpage.
Okay. Last, Benia?
Sir, regarding kay Senator, excuse me, Senator De Lima, sir, kahapon nagpa-check up siya sa heart center and then meron daw bukol sa kanyang kidney. Kung sakali, sir, mag-petition siya for a hospital arrest, ipapayagan yan pa dito ng palasyo?
Hindi po decision ng palasyo yan. Decision po yan ng hukuman.
Would you support it, sir, in case na magpetition siya?
We cannot support, we cannot oppose. It's the court that determines, but we wish her well because this is now a health issue. I don't think the President wishes anyone ill as far as health issues are concerned. As I said, we want her to enjoy a long life wherever, but we want to have her to have a long life.
Okay. Okay na, Belian. Questions? No more? Okay, thank you, Presidential Spokesperson Ari Roque.
Thank you very much and see you on Thursday.
Thank you, Malacanang Press Corps. Back to our main studio sa Radyo Pilipinas.
All right, so we've been listening to the Malacanang press conference there. A few comments, especially on the DOJ panel's recent dismissal of charges against suspected drug lords Peter Lim and Kerwin Espinosa. Secretary Roque said it was far from being final, that DOJ Secretary Aguirre will be reviewing that case and that the police can actually refile it with stronger evidence. The palace will be monitoring that as well. Said the dismissal does not affect the case against Senator Laila De Lima. In some other news, he fielded some questions, said China's call to respect Philippine sovereignty and is the correct response to criticism from the UN Rights Chief, and also confirming that Isa Seguera has resigned as National Youth Commission Chief. So we will leave it at that. Earlier, we did listen to the Senate hearing on charter change. We'll be bringing you an update on that as well. For now, we will give you your headlines on Dateline Philippines.